The problem for us is not, are our desires satisfied or not? The problem is, how do we know what we desire? There is nothing spontaneous, nothing natural about human desires. Our desires are artificial. We have to be taught to desire. Cinema is the ultimate pervert art. It doesn't give you what you desire. It tells you how to desire.
It just isn't good enough.
Oh, I forgot. Your mother asked me up to supper.
Okay. Bring some ice cream with you, will you?
Sure, what kind you want? Chocolate or vanilla?
Chocolate.
Okay.
What we get in this wonderful clip from Possessed is commentary on the magic art of cinema within a movie. We have an ordinary working-class girl living in a drab small provincial town. All of a sudden, she finds herself in a situation where reality itself reproduces the magic cinematic experience. She approaches the rail, the train is passing, and it is as if what in reality is just a person standing near a slowly passing train turns into a viewer observing the magic of the screen.
Have a drink? Oh, don't go away. Looking in? Wrong way. Get in and look out.
We get a very real, ordinary scene onto which the heroine's inner space, as it were, her fantasy space, is projected. So that although all reality is simply there, the train, the girl, part of reality in her perception and in our viewer's perception is, as it were, elevated to the magic level, becomes the screen of her dreams. This is cinematic art at its purest.
This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes.
But the choice between the blue and the red pill is not really a choice between illusion and reality. Of course, Matrix is a machine for fictions, but these are fictions which already structure our reality. If you take away from our reality the symbolic fictions that regulate it, you lose reality itself. I want a third pill. So what is the third pill? Definitely not some kind of transcendental pill which enables a fake fast food religious experience, but a pill that would enable me to perceive not the reality behind the illusion, but the reality in illusion itself. If something gets too traumatic, too violent, even too filled in with enjoyment, it shatters the coordinates of our reality. We have to fictionalize it.
The first key to horror films is to say, let's imagine the same story, but without the horror element. This gives us, I think, the background. We're in the middle of Bodega Bay, where the action of Hitchcock's Birds takes place. Birds is a film about a young, rich, socialite girl from San Francisco who falls in love with a guy, goes after him to Bodega Bay, where she discovers that he lives with his mother.
Because it's none of my business, but when you bring a girl like that...
Darling?
Yes?
I think I can handle Melanie Daniels by myself.
Well, as long as you know what you want, Mitch.
I know exactly what I want.
And then there is the standard Oedipal imbroglio of incestuous tension between mother and son, the son split between his possessive mother and the intrusive girl.
What's the matter with them?
What's the matter with all the birds?
Where'd you want this coffee?
In on the table, honey.
Hurry up with yours, Mitch. I'm sure Miss Daniels wants to be on her way.
I think you ought to stay the night, Melanie. We have an extra room upstairs and everything.
The big question about the birds, of course, is the stupid obvious one. Why do the birds attack?
Mitch?
It is not enough to say that the birds are part of the natural setup of reality. It is rather as if a foreign dimension intrudes that literally tears apart reality. We humans are not naturally born into reality. In order for us to act as normal people who interact with other people who live in a space of social reality, many things should happen, like we should be properly installed within the symbolic order and so on. When this, our proper dwelling within a symbolic space, is disturbed, reality disintegrates. So, to propose the psychoanalytic formula, the violent attacks of the birds are obviously explosive outbursts of maternal superego, of the maternal figure trying to prevent sexual relationship. So the birds are raw, incestuous energy.
What am I doing? I'm sorry, now I got it. My God, I'm thinking like Melanie. You know what I'm thinking now? I want to fuck Mitch. That's what she was thinking. No, I mean, no. Oh, sorry. I got this spontaneous confusion of directions.
Mrs. Bates.
We are in the cellar of the mother's house from Psycho. What's so interesting is that the very disposition of mother's house, events took place in it at three levels. First floor, ground floor, basement. It is as if they reproduce the three levels of human subjectivity. Ground floor is ego. Norman behaves there as a normal son, whatever remains of his normal ego taking over. Up there, it's the superego, maternal superego, because the dead mother is basically a figure of superego.
Now, Mother, I'm going to bring something up.
I am sorry, boy, but you do manage to look ludicrous when you give me orders.
Please, Mother.
No. I will not hide in the fruit cellar. You think I'm fruity, huh?
And down in the cellar, it's the id, the reservoir of these illicit drives. And so we can then interpret the event in the middle of the film when Norman carries the mother, or as we learn at the end, mother's mommy. corpse, skeleton, from the first floor to the cellar.
Won't do it again, not ever again. Now get out. I told you to get out, boy.
I'll carry you, Mother.
It's as if he is transposing her in his own mind as a psychic agency from superego to id.
Put me down. Put me down. I can walk on my...
Of course, the lesson of it is the old lesson elaborated already by Freud, that superego and id are deeply connected. The mother complains first as a figure of authority. How can you be doing this to me? Aren't you ashamed? This is a fruit seller. And then mother immediately turns into obscenity. Do you think I'm fruity? Superego is not an ethical agency. Superego is an obscene agency bombarding us with impossible orders, laughing at us when, of course, we cannot ever fulfill its demand. The more we obey it, the more it makes us guilty. There is always some aspect of an obscene madman in the agency of the superego. We often find references to psychoanalysis embodied in the very relations between persons. For example, the three Marx brothers, Groucho, Chico, Harpo. It's clear, Groucho, the most popular one, with his nervous hyperactivity, is superego.
Well, that covers a lot of ground. Say, you cover a lot of ground yourself. You better beat it. I hear they're going to tear you down and put up an office building where you're standing. You can leave in a taxi. If you can't get a taxi, you can leave in a huff. If that's too soon, you can leave in a minute and a huff. You know you haven't stopped talking since I came here?
Chico, the rational guy, egotistic, calculating all the time, is ego.
Ciccolini, you're charged with high treason. And if found guilty, you'll be shot.
I object.
Oh, you object. On what grounds?
I couldn't think of anything else to say.
Objection sustained.
And the weirdest of them all, Harpo, the mute guy, he doesn't talk. Freud said that drives are silent. He doesn't talk. He, of course, is id.
Who are you guys? What are you doing in my room?
As my partner, but he not speak. He's demoned off.
The id in all its radical ambiguity. Namely, what is so weird about the Harpo character is that he's childishly innocent, just striving for pleasure, likes children, plays with children, and so on. But at the same time, possessed by some kind of primordial evil, aggressive all the time. And this unique combination of utter corruption and innocence is what the id is about.
Yes, I'm Dr. Klein. This is Dr. Taylor.
Sharon, things have gotten worse since I found you. I think you better go upstairs.
Is she having spasms again?
Yeah, but they've gotten violent.
Did you give her the medication?
Voice
yes.
Is not an organic part of a human body. It's coming from somewhere in between your body. Whenever we talk to another person, there is always this minimum of ventriloquist effect, as if some foreign power took possession.
No power over.
The sound of the liquid would be powerless to harm.
Your mother sucks cocks in hell, Paris, you faithless slime.
Remember that at the beginning of the film, this was a beautiful young girl. How did she become a monster that we see? By being possessed? But who possessed her? A voice. A voice in its obscene dimensions.
See the cross of the Lord. Become your hostile power.
The first big film about this traumatic dimension of the voice. The voice which freely floats around and it's a traumatic presence feared the ultimate moment... object of anxiety which distorts reality was In 31, in Germany, Fritz Lang's The Testament of Dr. Mabuse.
Sie und diese Frau werden diesen Raum lebend nicht mehr verlassen.
Du Bestie! Komm,
um Gottes Willen!
Lass mich!
We do not see Mabuse till the end of the film. He is just a voice.
Großer Gott.
Sie werden diesen Raum lebend nicht mehr verlassen.
And to redeem to your son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
So the problem is, which is why we have the two priests at her side, how to get rid of this intruder, of this alien intruder. It is as if we are expecting the famous scene from Ridley Scott's Alien to repeat itself. As if we just wait for some terrifying alien, evil-looking small animal to jump out. There is a fundamental imbalance, gap, between our psychic energy, called by Freud libido, this endless, undead energy which persists beyond life and death, and the poor, finite, mortal reality of our bodies. This is not just the pathology of being possessed by ghosts. The lesson that we should learn and that the movies try to avoid is that we ourselves are the aliens. Our ego, our psychic agency, is an alien force distorting, controlling our body. Nobody was as fully aware of the properly traumatic dimension of the human voice. The human voice, not as the sublime ethereal medium for expressing the depth of human subjectivity, but the human voice as a foreign intruder. Nobody was more aware of this than Charlie Chaplin.
Hey, das Strafflitz-Hilfensekt! Der Wiener Schnitzel in der Lage werden und das Sauerkraut! Hey, der Filuten sagt der Filippen! Ein Tomenia wie sein Straff! Und der Blitzen sagt der Knut! Hey, ich leine Straff mit der Ach!
Chaplin himself plays in the film two persons. The good, small Jewish barber and his evil double,
Strafen!
Hinkel, dictator. Hitler, of course.
Come on!
Why, you?
Oh! Turn around! Oh, he bit my finger!
The Jewish barber, the tramp figure, is, of course, the figure of silent cinema. Silent figures are basically like figures in the cartoon. They don't know death. They don't know sexuality even. They don't know suffering. They just go on in that their oral, egotistic striving, like cats and mouse in a cartoon. You cut them into pieces. They're reconstituted. There is no finitude, no mortality here. There is evil, but a kind of a naive, good evil. You are just egotistic. You want to eat. You want to hit the other. But there is no guilt proper. What we get with sound is interiority, depth, guilt, culpability, in other words, the complex Oedipal universe.
Hey, you all, get a Hinkle button, get a Hinkle button. A fine photo with a buoy on each and every button.
The problem of the film, it's not only the political problem, how to get rid of totalitarianism, of its terrible seducting power, but it's also this more formal problem, how to get rid of this terrifying dimension of the voice. Or, since we cannot simply get rid of it, how to domesticate it? How to transform this voice, nonetheless, into the means of expressing humanity, love, and so on? German police grabs the poor tramp, thinking this is Hitler and he has to address a large gathering.
I'm sorry, but I don't want to be an emperor. That's not my business. I don't want to rule or conquer anyone. I should like to help everyone if possible. Jew, Gentile, black man, white. We all want to help one another. Human beings are like that.
There, of course, he delivers his big speech about the need of love, understanding between people. But there is a catch, even a double catch.
Soldiers, in the name of democracy, let us all unite!
People applaud exactly in the same way as they were applauding Hitler. The music that accompanies this great humanist finale, the overture to Wagner's opera Lohengrin, is the same music as the one we hear when Hitler is daydreaming about conquering the entire world and where he has a balloon in the shape of the globe. The music is the same. This can be read as the ultimate redemption of music, that the same music which served evil purposes can be redeemed to serve the good, or it can be read, and I think it should be read, in a much more ambiguous way, that with music we cannot ever be sure. Insofar as it externalizes our inner passion, music is potentially always a threat.
Llorando por tu amor, llorando por tu amor se llevó todo mi corazón.
There is a short scene in David Lynch's Mulholland Drive, which takes place in the theater where we are now, where behind the microphone a woman is singing, then out of exhaustion or whatever, she drops down. Surprisingly, the singing goes on. Immediately afterwards, it is explained. It was a playback. But for that couple of seconds, when we are confused, we confront this nightmarish dimension of an autonomous partial object. Like in the well-known adventure of Cheshire Cat from Alice in Wonderland, where the cat disappears, the smile remains.
You may have noticed that I'm not all there myself. And the Mormons are
The fascinating thing about partial objects, in the sense of organs without bodies, is that they embody what Freud called death drive. Here we have to be very careful. Death drive is not kind of a Buddhist striving for annihilation, I want to find eternal peace, No, death drive is almost the opposite. Death drive is the dimension of what in the Stephen King-like horror fiction is called the dimension of the undead, of living dead, of something which remains alive even after it is dead and it's in a way immortal in its deadness itself, goes on, insists. You cannot destroy it. The more you cut it, the more it insists, it goes on. This dimension of kind of diabolical undeadness is what partial objects are about. The nicest example here for me, I think, is Michael Powell's Red Shoes, about a ballerina. Her passion for dancing is materialized in her shoes taking over. The shoes are literally the undead object. Perhaps the ultimate bodily part which fits this role of the autonomous partial object is the fist, or rather, the hand. This hand raising up, that's the whole point of the film. It's not simply something foreign to him. It's the very core of his personality out there.
Security?
I am Jack's smirking revenge. Oh!
Oh! What the hell are you doing?
Far from standing for some kind of perverted masochism or reactionary fantasy of violence, this scene is deeply liberating. I'm here, as it were, on the side of the fist. I think this is what liberation means. In order to attack the enemy, you first have to beat the shit out of yourself, to get rid in yourself to that which in yourself attaches you to the leader, to the conditions of slavery, and so on and so on.
No, please stop! Oh. Oh. What are you doing? Oh God, no, please, no!
For some reason, I thought of my first fight with Tyler.
There is always this conflict between me and my double.
Motherfucker! You hit me in the ear!
Well, Jesus, I'm sorry.
Ow! Christ! Why the ear, man?
I fucked it up.
Kind of. Oh, that was perfect.
It is as if the double embodies myself, but without the castrated dimension of myself. There is an episode in the wonderful British horror classic, Dead of Night.
I knew you wouldn't leave me, Hugo. I knew you'd come back.
In which Michael Redgrave plays a ventriloquist who gets jealous of his puppet.
Oh, don't get excited. I was only joking. You know me. My fool! My fool! They can't leave!
Stop here!
In an outburst of violence, destroys. The puppet breaks down. Then, in the very last scene of the film, we see him in the hospital, slowly regaining consciousness, coming back to himself. First, his voice is stuck in the throat. Then, with great difficulty, finally, he is able to talk. But he talks with the distorted voice of the dummy.
Hello, Sylvester. I've been waiting for you.
And the lesson is clear. The only way for me to get rid of this autonomous partial object is to become this object. Anytime you are ready, tell me.
Okay.
Wait a minute. So that I don't confuse them. Where is Mikey? Mikey is here. His one is here. Okay. You shout. I'm standing on the very balcony where the traumatic murder scene occurs in conversation. The murder of the husband, observed through the stained glass in front of me by the private detective, Gene Hackman. The detective is in the nearby room. Significantly, just before he sees the murder, he observes the balcony through a crack in the glass wall. Whenever we have this famous proverbial peeping Tom scene of somebody observing traumatic event through a crack, it's never as if we are dealing with two parts on both sides of the wall of the same reality. Before seeing anything or imagining to see something, he tries to listen. He behaves as an eavesdropper with all his private detective gadgets. What does this make him? Potentially, at least, it makes him into a fantasized, imagined entity.
I can't stand it. I can't stand it.
He doesn't fantasize the scene of the murder. He fantasizes himself as a witness to the murder.
I love you.
What he sees on that blurred window, glass which effectively functions as a kind of elementary screen, cinematic screen even, that should be perceived as a desperate attempt to visualize, hallucinate even, the bodily material support of what he hears.
Hello, baby.
Shut up! I'm scared of you, shithead. Where's my bourbon?
Dorothy's apartment is one of those hellish places which abound in David Lynch's films. A place where all moral or social inhibitions seem to be suspended, where everything is possible. The lowest masochistic sex, obscenities, the deepest level of our desires that we are not even ready to admit to ourselves, we are confronted with them in such places.
Spread your legs. Wider. Show it to me. Don't you fucking look at me.
From what perspective should we observe this scene? Imagine the scene as that of a small child hidden in a closet or behind a door,
Mommy,
witnessing the parental intercourse. He doesn't yet know what sexuality is, how we do it. All he knows is what he hears, this strange deep breathing sound, and then he tries to imagine what goes on. At the very beginning of Blue Velvet, we see Jeffrey's father having a heart attack, falling down. We have the eclipse of the normal paternal authority.
Mommy.
Mommy loves you.
Baby wants to fuck.
It is as if Jeffrey fantasizes this wild parental couple of Dorothy and Frank as kind of a phantasmatic supplement to the lack of the real paternal authority.
Get ready to fuck! You fuckers, fucker! You fucker! Don't you fucking look at me!
Frank not only obviously acts, but even overacts. It is as if he's ridiculously excessive, gesticulating, shouting, and so on, are here to cover up something. The point is, of course, the elementary one, to convince the invisible observer that father is potent, to cover up father's impotence. So the second way to read the scene would have been as a spectacle, a ridiculously violent spectacle set up by the father to convince the son of his power, of his overpotency. The third way would have been to focus on Dorothy herself. Many feminists, of course, emphasized the brutality against women in this scene, the abuse, how the Dorothy character is abused. There is obviously this dimension in it. But I think one should risk a more shocking and obverse interpretation. What if the central, as it were, problem of this entire scene is Dorothy's passivity?
Don't you fucking look at me!
So what if what Frank is doing is a kind of a desperate, ridiculous, but nonetheless effective attempt of trying to help Dorothy, to awaken her out of her lethargy, to bring her into life? So if Frank is anybody's fantasy, maybe he is Dorothy's fantasy. There is kind of a strange mutual interlocking of fantasies.
You're still alive, baby.
It's not only ambiguity, but oscillation between three focal points. This, I think, is what accounts for the strange reverberations of this scene. This brings us to our third and maybe crucial example. What is, for me, the most beautiful shot in the entire Vertigo.